a city can best be understood straightforwardly in its own terms, rather than in terms of some other kinds of organisms or objects. However, if the slippery shorthand of analogy can help, perhaps the best analogy is to imagine a large field in darkness. In the field, many fires are burning. They are of many sizes, some great, others small, some far apart, others dotted close together. Some are brightening, some are slowly going out. Each fire, large or small, extends its radiance into the surrounding murk, and thus it carves out a space. But the space and the shape of that space exist only to the extent that the light from the fire creates it. Only intricacy and vitality of use give to the parts of the city appropriate structure and shape. Wherever the fires of use and vitality fail to extend in the city is a place in the murk, a place essentially without city form or structure.
And with that strange and somewhat enigmatic quote, we start About Buildings and Cities. I'm George Gingell.
I'm Luke Jones.
And today we're going to talk about Jane Jacobs, specifically her book.
The Death and Life of Great American Cities is one of the big books of the 1960s. It's probably one of the most read books on cities and urbanism, and it's arguably one of the most influential. I think it owes a lot of that to its readability, but it's also a book kind of packed full of ideas originating in the kind of intelligence that is really prepared to take on a lot of received ideas about the city at that time simultaneously. This is going to be an episode where we're just basically going to go through the whole book, say what it says, and say what we think about it.
Given the way that things always expand, I think mostly talking about the book is probably the best idea. Should we say who she is?
Yeah, so Jane Jacobs, born Jane Butzner in Scranton, Pennsylvania.
Just like Biden, probably only about 10 years later.
Yes, she was born in the 1915 or 16, I think. I mean, we'll probably have cause to talk about Scranton, because she one of her big ideas is that there's something special about big cities, which is not true of small cities like Scranton, which I think is the sixth largest city in Pennsylvania, and was probably around the time of her birth still a pretty happening place. It was very high-tech, coal city, with streetcars, electrification, ahead of a lot of other cities. But I think by the time in the 30s that she came to leave it and move to New York, it was very much on a sort of downward trend, which would basically continue until, I guess, 1980s or something like that. I've had a look at it on Google Maps. It's kind of interesting. It's sort of, if you sort of poke around the street view of it, its streets look like America in the movies. You have the thing of sort of big wooden houses with sort of sidewalks which are grass with a little path going down the middle of it. And the houses are sort of relatively close together, but large, like very wide. They're probably about 10 or 12 meters wide, tree lined. It's the kind of place that people make the mistake of falling asleep and get butchered by Freddy Krueger, you know, that kind of thing. It's a sort of stock American location. It looks like that for a person sort of looking at it from outside. It looks like normal America in the movies, basically.
Her family were...
They were wealthy. They were like... Or not wealthy, but they were well off.
Yes. Nice family background. And clearly, the family was very supportive of intellectual and academic endeavours. She seems to have read very widely. Her brother became a judge. And she seems to have had an adventuring mind and a strong will, according to what people say. The received wisdom, anyway. I don't know how true any of this is. This is all like what someone said in an interview.
Her and her sister Betty moved to New York in 1935 when she would have been about 20. I don't know whether Betty was older or younger.
To study. Yes, I think she studied for a few years. The received wisdom is she academically didn't get on with her teachers. And then had a great fun. Did she go to Columbia?
Yeah, Barnard, which is the sort of woman's bit of Columbia.
And took a wide... In America, they've got a very different system to here. You don't have to do a subject. Yes. You can sort of just take subjects at the beginning. Like in the UK, you have to really nail down what you're going to do right at the beginning and then regret it and change 2 years later.
Yeah, well, as a like 15-year-old, you've sort of got to start taking the right courses.
It's possible to sort of subvert the system, but yes, you're very much narrow, a much narrower focus. And she seems to have been able to study a very wide range of subjects. The first thing she wrote about was rejects from the American Constitution, things that weren't included initially, but also sort of some interest in science and geology and maths and things, but none taken very far, like successful at the sort of first round of subjects. And then not wishing to take anything else or do any further studies to get the degree, she got a job as a journalist, writing for, I don't know what initially.
She wrote for a bunch of different things, like a series of different magazines. I mean, it was during the war at a publication called America, with a K.
Yes, classy that.
That she met her husband, Robert Jacobs.
This was a propaganda magazine about American life for the Soviet Union.
Must have been great fun. Yeah. And then he was an architect, but he was moonlighting designing warplanes.
That's good fun. Yeah, a lot of people are doing that. I don't know how good any of them were at this, but they certainly sort of recruited a lot of designers in the hope that like these broad minds would be able to do something. Possibly on the thing that, well, you're not going to be doing any buildings. I don't know what else you're going to be doing.
Yeah, yeah. Fomenting trouble. Well, she had moved, I think, originally to Greenwich Village, which is in on Manhattan, sort of towards the bottom, isn't it? I think initially, and they, but they, the Jacobses also bought a house there during the war. No, I think in 1944.
A couple of like really obvious things is she leaves Scranton at the height of the Great Depression, or I suppose we're in a kind of New Deal period, but that really didn't resolve the economic problems, and that's when she moves to New York. But her career as a journalist is starting in the kind of boom post-war era. Yeah, it's funny because the couple of times I've heard her mention anything about Scranton in an interview, she has this strange combination of a sort of nostalgia for a lovely place that she grew up in, which has this strange quality of like being sort of developed an intriguing, dynamic town with interest and quirkiness. Then other times she will talk about it as being like deathly dull and flat. I don't think she had a bad time there at all. No. I think she wanted to go to the big city, but I don't think it doesn't sound like it's a bad memories of growing up there at all.
So this book was kind of originates in the 50s and was published in 1961. In her job working at Architecture Forum, she kind of was embedded in the whole sort of planning and architecture scene and knew lots of planners, lots of architects, was very on top of everything which was happening in the city. This is obviously a period of great kind of infrastructural redevelopment from the sort of New Deal onwards, which involved building a lot of transport infrastructure, particularly for automobiles, and also new housing projects.
There's a super cycle going on, which is that the population in the East Coast, and in fact in London as well, follows exactly this trajectory, which I know more about, but I checked it out which is that the populations of city centres peak around the end of the First World War and decline probably until the late 1980s or early 1990s. And in that period, suburbia grows enormously. The population of Manhattan peaks at 2.3 million just after the First World War and loses about 40% to the 70s. And along with that, there's a huge change in the way cities operate, where you get these huge sprawling suburbs with cars and people move out because of that. And so you're going from the kind of industrial city of super densely inhabited. There aren't more buildings then than there are now. Just way more people, way less buildings, way less space, massive density of people. Slowly as transport links build up, kind of the population becomes more diffuse. and they're able, people are able to move out of incredibly crowded city centres and find a new life further out commuting in, and the beginning of commuting occurs.
That's a sort of background thing. But then there's also a kind of culture that she's reacting against, which involves, there's a general sort of program of regeneration, which is proposed for all of these big, all kind of cities of, at all scales on both sides of the Atlantic. This sort of movement out of cities, but also there's a sort of general sense that like cities have become incredibly run down. There's an enormous amount of substandard housing. There's terrible urban poverty. Kind of physical structure of the city in terms of its buildings is heavily indicted for its unsuitability for kind of the type of life that we want people to live in this, in the good post-war society that we're all going to build together. And there is also a kind of very clear redirection of the energy and kind of coordinating ability of the wartime state towards the ends of peace. You know, there's the classic Labour poster for the immediately post-war election is now win the peace, but and it's kind of, which sort of is the program that we're going to sort of take all of the technology and the kind of technocratic capabilities of the state and we're going to point it at poverty or lack of housing or anything else.
Yeah, it's interesting, obviously, examining this from an American point of view, because in Europe we're very used to the reason that there was going to be loads of inner city building was because the cities were quite blown up. That doesn't necessarily completely stand up to close interrogation, because obviously a lot of stuff that wasn't blown up was also knocked down, which you wouldn't think, you know, there's still lots and lots of slum clearance in London, but the initial impetus is certainly that, yeah, a third of the buildings in London have been destroyed.
Or damaged.
In the city, two-thirds of buildings have lost their roofs and one-third have been destroyed in the city centre. Over the whole of London, about a third were damaged. But, and then subsequently, rather more than that, were knocked down. And some were done up. They didn't demolish the Houses of Parliament because they were bombed.
The sort of London equivalent of this is the Abercrombie plan, this famous sort of beautiful blobby colour plan of the whole of London. Lots of people like to use, but very few people, I think, ever read the key, which explicitly says, like, all of these brown bits, which is almost everything, contains large amounts of redundant buildings. Like, subtext, should be knocked down.
And also, it was explicitly the population, explicitly the understanding that they were going to, people already started moving out, and they were going to move loads more people out of the centre. And the idea was, like, lots of the city can become green by virtue of people not living there anymore.
Yeah, or there's the is it called the Buchanan plan. There's this wonderful, that's the one for Glasgow, which is a sort of a plan, in my memory it's shown in Axonometric, and essentially they knock down everything except for the castle and the university in the whole city and then build all these sort of blocks and things. It's they didn't adopt it in the end, but it's kind of shows the sort of mental universe that we're in, which is that the city is massively not fit for purpose. And
yeah, and I want to make this is because it's something that Jane Jacobs never says. I want to point out that a lot of the houses that were people were living in astonishingly bad conditions, not just in the cities, also in the countryside. But like lots of people didn't have any plumbing, lots and lots of people had to share buildings that would normally you'd think of being lived in by one family had to be lived in by multiple. That had been in London exacerbated by the war, but that's also a bit of an issue because it was like that before the war. And that's why when people had an opportunity, a lot of people left to get bigger houses in the Ribbon development, was because those houses would have plumbing and enough room for, you know, room for the kids to have their own bedroom. That sort of thing. It is important to say that it's not purely a malicious instinct to try and these were also still cities which you had horrible outbreaks of disease because of unsanitary conditions, which are, I think there's a thing where cities change, are in the same space over time, but the character of areas over long periods of time changes so much. But the place is so familiar that it's almost impossible to put yourself in the mind of a different age. And when we're talking about the life and death of great American cities, we in a way have to put ourselves in the mind frame of several different periods of cities which are strangely familiar because they are the same place, but which actually are dealing with very different social challenges.
Yeah, the reason I sort of brought this up is just to say that this book is, like so many, clearly a book motivated by lots of arguments that she's had with particular people and a sort of general condition of wrongness, of a kind of faulty cognitive mapping that seems to be shaping the thinking of the sort of dominant culture of planners and architects. And so she has this sort of experience, a kind of generic form of the experience that she recounts will be walking around a neighborhood which she thinks to be vibrant, alive, perfectly well functioning, full of happy people living in their own way, but which to the architecture or urban design eggheads is a slum which needs to be condemned, which is clearly like unfit for human habitation, and which desperately needs to be replaced by the new model of kind of buildings in a park, which she in turn regards as being kind of failures in all sorts of ways. But we should kind of get into the specifics of that in the context of the book. It's clear that she's had an enormous number of kind of radicalizing encounters through the 40s and 50s with those people, and that her thinking has shifted faster and faster through the 50s until she's really sure that she wants to reject the whole kind of basis of this way of looking at the city. And then also she's clearly been radicalized by this other event, which was the proposal to drive a big expressway through close to her home in Greenwich Village, which was the LOMEX, the Lower Manhattan Expressway, an extension, I believe, of Interstate 78 or something like that, masterminded by this famous kind of villain, Robert Moses. He's this kind of J. Edgar Hoover-like figure, this sort of incredibly long-lived, unsackable bureaucrat.
He reminded me a bit of Bazalgette in London, who we now associate just with the sewers, but actually is someone who kind of like creates an entire, or like somehow around themselves, creates an entire order of, well, at one hand, enabling a kind of fractious, disorganized, an angry city to like carry out projects on a massive scale, like walking all over interests of lots of different people to get stuff done, and he gets a lot of stuff done. But it kind of, obviously, in one sense, that creates a lot of new infrastructure, a lot of new housing, and at the same time, it's being driven through by this kind of, he's now like a demonic figure.
It does seem excessive.
It doesn't seem right, but that's certainly the image. And he certainly was someone who managed to use the tools of local government, particularly the kind of bureaucratic structures of local government, you know, all these kind of institutions and agencies that are set up to do various tasks and have various bits of power, control within those, to kind of consolidate and get big projects that are extremely difficult to get done. If you think about the business of actually getting a major infrastructure project done in a city, it's something which is extremely difficult.
I think part of that is also that he had originated and helped to set up the organisations during the New Deal, particularly, which were empowered to spend money and to make those things happen. That's why I sort of likened him to J. Edgar Hoover. Like, I think he owed his fortification within that structure to the fact that he'd helped set it all up, and he kind of...
Yeah, it was just true of Bazalgette, again, in London. Like, there is, at the beginning of his period, there is essentially no local government infrastructure of London at all. And by the end, he's, through kind of boards of works and the water board and that sort of stuff, basically set up London County Council.
Well, maybe one of the things we should look at in the bonus, actually, is that the LOMEX project itself was actually quite an amazing proposal. It has these unbelievably science fictional renderings by... There's a version by Paul Rudolph.
Yeah, it goes through a lot of iterations. It starts much less excitingly, but the last one has got this really curious...
Yeah, unbelievably, like, science fictional-looking flying, exploding ziggurat structure. Let's talk about them on the bonus, among other things, because I think they're really cool anyway. But thankfully, she frustrated that so that Greenwich Village could
carry on. I think initially the thing that she was objecting to is they were going to basically widen a road, but also the park like blocks one of the avenues, and it was going to have the road that was going up there was going to be widened and go straight through the middle of the park.
It's the build-up to Christmas. It's probably just tripping into December. Certainly minds will be turning that way. The question of Christmas shopping is a little bit sort of vexed, isn't it, George?
Very vexed. Yes. Wouldn't know anything about that.
The prospect of buying everything on Amazon doesn't exactly fill the heart with joy. So why not instead support a small architectural publisher? Blue Crow Media, who are the sponsors of this episode, are publishers of architecture and design maps of cities from Paris to Pyongyang.
The format is each of them addresses a theme of something interesting about that city. So we've got trees of London, modernists, Soviet modernist architecture in Moscow, concrete megastructures of Seoul, interesting concrete buildings. And they kind of at once show you the layout and grain of the city in a way particularly styled to bring out that property that's being looked at, and show you where the best buildings are, and on the back, show you the buildings.
Yeah, I'm looking at one that I've been sent, which is Tbilisi. When we're allowed to travel again is one of the places I very much want to go to. And there's some great stuff on here. There's the unbelievable Ministry of Transport, now Bank of Georgia, in Gagarin Street. You probably know this one. It's the one that looks like kind of flying Jenga. It's also got all of the names in Georgian, in the lovely Georgian script, which is this very attractive, very graphically sort of striking, wiggly writing. So yeah, do yourself or someone else a favour. Buy some maps from Blue Crow for Christmas. Their website is bluecrowmedia.com. And if you buy, please do yourself and us a favour and use the offer code aboutbuildings, which is all one word, at checkout for 10% off. So thanks a lot to Blue Crow, and back to Jane Jacobs. So it's a work in four parts. The first part is about how cities really work, particularly in terms of public space.
Well, there's an introduction which has some points which are important and not included in any of the parts as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, there's this kind of opening framing, which is that city planning is a kind of pseudoscience, that it's like medicine in the era of bloodletting.
So it starts with examples of the error as well. And it also starts with this book is an attack on urban planning. I can't remember exactly what the phrase is, but it's almost like, I have written a book to attack urban planning. It's that kind of clear. It's a polemic against these urban interventions. And it then also lists what she takes to be the kind of historic arc that's brought about this era through, I mean, a number of figures, but most crucially, Ebenezer Howard's Garden City and Le Corbusier's City of Tomorrow.
They, or rather their sort of inheritors, who she calls the decentrists, are people who want to sort of destroy the dense, intense, vital heart of the city and to fill it with plants, to move people out into kind of orderly, dull dwellings in parkland.
Ebenezer Howard's, which is a English Victorian idea, is that we're not going to have big cities. We're going to have small sort of mixed industrial residential cities of 20,000 people with lots of amenities and huge amounts of green space, surrounded by green belts connected by railways. And that's kind of what the country is going to be like. And everyone is going to be away from those dark satanic mills, and also away from squalor and out in fresh air. And the countryside is no longer going to be depopulated of sturdy peasants. And Corbusier, as we've talked about a lot, is an extremely radical plan to demolish initially the centre of Paris and replace it with a grid, basically, of tower blocks with sort of complicated roads going between them, and then having a kind of isolated cultural and shopping centre in the middle, and then other ones with pavilions around, all set in parkland.
Oh, yeah. The demolishing Paris one is really a development of the initial model. Unlike Howard, who thought you could kind of disperse people everywhere, he thought that you had to concentrate them massively into these huge cruciform tower blocks.
And in essence, it's kind of like Howard's, but the key difference is you've got more transport, but you just take the kind of ground floor plan of the Howard city of 20,000 people and extrude it up until you've got a city of a million people.
Well, then, no, the Howard one is, like, spread out. I mean, if you go to any of the garden cities, they're spread out, and it's not just... The Corbusier ideal is of a big shared English garden, like a kind of landscape garden, whereas the Howard one, there is an awful lot of, like, having your own little vegetable pouch as well.
Yeah, that's true. It's concentrated in the lumps and then extruded up a long way. But also in Corbusier, everyone blooming has an allotment as well. Like, the amount of time he spent talking about allotments is ridiculous.
Well, there's some of the housing types people have allotments, yeah. In the flying ones, though, they don't take up the ground plane enormously.
No, he doesn't really like the... He's kind of got his... Anyway, we're getting distracted. We've talked about this at length in another episode.
So the book itself covers these four, really her kind of own theory of urban planning, or really urbanism, like how cities exist and how they develop. And the parts are, first of all, about how cities really work, which she kind of calls for a refounding of that idea based on the sort of empirical observation of the way things really are, and in her own argument kind of furnished enormously by anecdote, personal sort of reflection, and then also interesting things that people have told her. So the first part is really about public spaces, and then there's a bit about diversity of uses, so more about buildings, about the sort of dynamics between buildings, and then the third part is about how cities, as well as being willfully destroyed by bad planning, can kind of destroy themselves by things which go wrong in their own internal dynamics. And then the last part is a kind of consideration of tactics for addressing some of the inevitable things which go wrong in the city, and what she thinks are better remedies for them than the sort of existing ones of regeneration than existing forms.
And also there's right at the end a little manifesto for how we should begin to think about urban planning and the development of urban planning as a science at the end.
Yeah, that's all kind of knitted into the tactics, yeah.
The sort of evidence that she draws on are journalistic examples and personal accounts. And another thing is that this is a book that is concerned with the social and economic structure of cities. It's not like Corbusier, driven with a sort of future where an aesthetic and technology combine, or a notion of kind of moulding a different sort of society like Ebenezer Howard, or it's certainly not something like Aldo Rossi talking about kind of the spirit of a city in some more abstract way. All of these, it's really concerned with how a good society and economy exist in local areas of a city.
Yeah, and I think that that's founded on an idea that what urban planning tends to miss, or the then prevailing way of thinking about urban planning, was to understand the city through functions and to understand it as a kind of interaction of processes within which the actual human component could be conceived a little bit like the water in a sort of hydrostatic computer or something, you know, like it's a kind of neutral medium which gets squished between the like industry engine and the commerce engine and the residence engine, and it needs to be like allowed into the countryside enough to keep it
well-tempered. Is that a reference to the Keynesian water computer?
Yeah. There's the famous economic hydrostatic computer thing, whereas her thing is that the city all consists in relationships between human activities. I mean, we'll get onto it later. The quote we had at the start of the program, the fires are a good example. Her analogy, it made me think a little bit of like a nuclear pile. Like you've got to get the various rods kind of have got to be close enough together.
But also appropriately moderated. You've got to slow your fast neutrons to slow neutrons.
Yeah.
And then they can react successfully.
If you just have them in different corners of the room, it's never going to do anything. You've got to get them in so that they start generating a bit of heat. Obviously, they've got to not run away and burn a hole in the floor, which is a phenomenon in the city she will have a kind of version of. The first part is the most famous part. It's by far the best known part, by far the most read part, and it has the most famous passages in it. And I feel like it's also very clearly addressed to the sort of preferences of the kind of Robert Moses school of urban design. Moses loved parks. Parks were like the thing which he did lots,
And then, as well as parks, he liked parkways, which are big roads for cars. So, in turn, hers is all about sidewalks, which we call pavements.
Pavements, but in this country, yep.
But then in America, pavement is what the cars drive on. So part one is called The Peculiar Nature of Cities. But yeah, it's really about the way in which the shared elements of the city function and the what makes them work well. And the thing which she wants to make a big case for is the sidewalk as this thing which is not like a piece of transportation infrastructure or something that you use purely to get around, but which actually has a very complex sort of socially embedded life with all sorts of actual functions which arise out of its embedding in the society of the neighborhood. And the one that she singles out first is security, is safety. That's the one which is kind of foregrounded. I mean, we were talking about it before and you were saying it was a slightly peculiar thing to focus on.
Early on in the book, certainly, it fades somewhat, but in this first chapter, the principal problem with cities is street crime. That is what the city should be set up to avoid.
And I sort of wondered about that, whether that is the, to some extent, you do have to make an argument in the terms which are then recognizable, that you sort of, yeah, perhaps if you want to make an argument for something, you have to do it in on the terms of this sort of busybody-ish language of delinquency and pervert.
There may be that there was a lot more, as I said, a vanished city. There may have been, crime may have been a much bigger problem back then. Personally, I'm not sure New York of the cities was as crime-ridden as it would become later. The next one I thought is, the other two things she spends her time doing is she's a journalist, and there's always a great journalistic interest in the problems of blighted areas and street crime. That feels like something that you could write sensational stories about. And the third one is she seems to spend a lot of time campaigning against these urban projects in various kind of community bodies. And they are, in my experience, obsessed with people doing the wrong thing. My limited experience of being on them, people's annoyances at the behaviour of and the sort of malpractices of their neighbours, particularly the neighbours who are not belonging to quite the community they belong to, is a source of immense interest and fascination. And I thought those three things could lead you to being very interested in the effects of street crime.
So the argument to really sketch it is that the sidewalk produces safety because,
well, this is the good, healthy, the right sort of sidewalk that we will outline later.
Under conditions where enough people use it and there's sort of a kind of environment which allows it to be surveilled by people who are close to it. But essentially the argument is that surveilled by people whose businesses or homes open up onto it, it's safe because people exercise a kind of, they see what's going on and they look out for one another. And one of, I think, the two most famous passages in this book is this description of how the sidewalk outside her house carries out this function, which is the description of, maybe I'll just read it, a bit of it out. They're a little bit long, some of these.
Yeah, she's not a concise and incisive writer. They're nice stories, but they kind of can be a little elliptical.
Yeah, so this is outside her house. She's looking out of her window. The incident that attracted my attention was a suppressed struggle going on between a man and a little girl of 8 or 9 years old. The man seemed to be trying to get the girl to go with him. By turns, he was directing a cajoling attention to her and then assuming an air of nonchalance. The girl was making herself rigid, as children do when they resist, against the wall of one of the tenements across the street. As I watched from our second floor window, making up my mind how to intervene if it seemed advisable, I saw that it was not going to be necessary. From the butcher shop beneath the tenement had emerged the woman who, with her husband, runs the shop. She was standing within earshot of the man, her arms folded, and a look of determination on her face. Joe Cornacchia, who with his son-in-law keeps the delicatessen, emerged about the same moment and stood solidly to the other side. Several heads poked out of the tenement windows above. One was withdrawn quickly and its owner reappeared a moment later in the doorway behind the man. It sort of goes on. The man did not know it, but he was surrounded. No one was going to allow the little girl to be dragged off, even if nobody knew who she was. I'm sorry, purely for dramatic reasons, to have to report that the little girl turned out to be the man's daughter.
It's a very interesting story, isn't it? She gives other examples. And I think we can discuss this thesis a little bit. So if you want to prevent, you know, muggings, if you've got an area where there's people around all the time. You don't get much of that. Although you do still get people like coming along on scooters nicking stuff. I can tell you from experience. But this story is a sort of strange one, isn't it? It's an interesting example to choose. It feels very ambivalent. So the daughter doesn't want to go with the father and is being acting strange around them. And it's fine.
It's fine, but if he had been trying to kidnap or hurt her, he would have been prevented because of the community justice.
But it is true that if you have a community of people in a space, you get a lot less.
I think also it is a sort of powerful demonstration, and it's one of the I think it's one of the things which is often forgotten, certainly in the pathologization of the design of certain places where there is crime. So, I mean, this will then later be true of many of the housing estates built in the post-war. But it's also, you know, there's now a thing called designing out crime, where the police are consulted.
Secure by design.
Oh, secure by design,
secure,
yeah.
Secure by design. That's what you have to get, like, the blooming standard you have to conform to.
Yeah, no, there's now a part of the building regulations or whatever, which specifies what kind of locks you have to have on your windows. But it's stupid. I think basically it is stupid, actually.
The secure by design is, although I don't think that's what's going on here.
Is the opposite of that, is what I mean. And I think that actually this is a corrective to that kind of thinking, which is that security can be procured by designing things in a particular way.
Yeah, secure by design is about hardening building targets against burglary and vandalism. That's what it really feels like.
If you've ever been to a bank, you'll know that, like, secure by design can go an awful long way without actually making places immune from being robbed. The things which you're trying to prevent have to be prevented socially by the consent of the people involved rather than by technological means. I mean, you can use technology to catch them afterwards relatively effectively, but you can't prevent people from doing things very effectively with technology, and the attempts to do so almost always make them into horrible places.
Yes, it's a problem, but not perhaps this one. Essentially, what that requires to have eyes on the street, which also, by the way, like, I think we can possibly talk about, like, some things that might be less inviting about this system of social control, but the thing that it requires is a dynamic community of people who are on the street all the time.
You're around all the time. I think that this is exemplary of the strength of her way of making an argument, which is that she is very observant and that she has a very lively way of identifying what the explanatory value of an anecdote is and of making it tell a particular story. And I think that this one really does tell this story very effectively. The term eyes on the street is good because it does also have a slightly sinister ring to it. And there is obviously, like, the problem with community justice is if you're sort of not in the community or if you're, like, systematically outside of it. Around this time, I think over a number of years, but still being published at this time, there's this famous African-American automobile guide, isn't there? Which is a sort of guide for driving around the United States and which has its famous designation of some places as sundown towns, which are communities within which it would not be safe to be after nightfall. And that is also a factor of eyes on the street, actually, but yeah, their particular kind of eyes.
It's a bit of an extreme case, though, isn't
it? It's an extreme case, but it's actually, like, they were all over the place. This, to a minor degree, version is all kind of rampant in community groups of all kinds, and
everyone knows what's going on, and it's very good at enforcing social norms.
Yes, so, yeah. Well, I mean, and there's a good example of this. So later in this part, there's a discussion of her friend Joe Cornacchia, who is, I can't remember what he does. He does one of the shops anyway. It's either him or it's the locksmith. Anyway, they talk about how they want to get rid of the local comfort station, which I believe is a public convenience, which they want to get rid of. Because it's unspecified why they want to get rid of it. But one of the main reasons for wanting to reform various items of local infrastructure is their infestation by perverts.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this is a public convenience problem. As when I got my work experience, like age 14, it was at an architecture practice in Cambridge, and we were taking down one public toilet and building some other ones. And there's obviously all the problems of, like, people injecting in them, but the sort of euphemistic spectre of, like, gay men doing hookups was kind of perpetually addressed as a background you know, can we talk to them and say that this one, can we talk to the community and say this one's not for you? And then my boss said, I've always been wanting to propose the one that is for them. What amenities would be best suited for, because you wouldn't want to make it too, and it would remove the frisson. Anyway, yeah, I think
well,
we know.
What I mean, that's a kind of factor of eyes on the street as well, isn't it? Like, who is a pervert?
Yeah, I mean, we should get into this in the parks bit because I think the parks description is much better.
If you're not in the if you're not in the community, you are in danger of being a pervert, which is obviously is a hard road.
Well,
I
you
think.
Know, yeah, you know, terrible, terrible state that Greenwich Village. I mean, isn't Stonewall literally in Greenwich Village?
I remember someone telling me that there's a nice reminiscence by Samuel Delaney, the science fiction author who was living in Harlem. I think probably at this time, actually, writing, you know, extremely wild and wonderful science fiction. And he would, you know, dash off 1,000 words or so and then go out for a lunchtime stroll, leaving the old ball and chain at home and go and suck a guy off in a public convenience. And that was, you know, that was the thrill and kind of intensity of city life for him at that time. And there's an innate tension because people do want different things, actually.
In a sense, the problems with Eyes on the Street are problems of society rather than the problems of the village.
If your solution is a social solution, it kind of moves the problems to the problems of society.
Yeah, I mean, people also move to the city to be anonymous, and that is one of its great charms. The street that she's wanting to have is one where you've got local sort of shops and restaurants and cafes at a sort of a reasonable density, and it's inhabited by all members of the community. Kids can come and play and go to school, and families and people on their way to work, all going on in the community, you know, with a community that has got work and people living there. But because of all this day round people on the street at some in some number, there's both Eyes on the Street and also the street is a lively and fun place, able to sustain businesses and a community and be a pleasant place to live. So I wouldn't say it's the only nice model of urban life, but it's one of the desirable models of urban life.
Yeah. So she had probably the most famous passage in the book is this description of her street, which she describes as an intricate sidewalk ballet. Very enjoyable, very rich description of absolutely everything that happens through the course of the day. I can't read the whole thing because it's extremely long, but some little samples of it are, you know, she goes out early on while the children are going to school to sweep up the candy wrappers left on the doorstep. You know, the people are going to the bus. Well-dressed and elegant women with briefcases emerge from doorways and side streets. Women in house dresses are emerging and kind of crisscrossing and talking to one another. They're out for the day. Then there are the longshoremen who come up and go to some of the various bars. There's executives and people who come for business lunches. There's the locksmith kind of opening and shutting his shop. He goes off in the middle of the day to go to the cigar store. There's the tailor who goes out to water all his plants. The women with the babies in their baby carriages come out.
So far,
you know.
So, Monsieur Hulot.
It is, though. It is. It's very idyllic. And but then the punchline of it is important because it goes all the way through, and then, like, it goes on deep into the night. There are people out in the bars. There are people kind of going out and singing. At one point, she has a description of someone turns up with some bagpipes, and they all play the bagpipes, and everyone goes out and dances around the person with the bagpipes, which I think feels like...
I don't believe it.
Yeah. And then it says, one night a young man came roaring along, bellowing terrible language at two girls whom he'd apparently picked up and who were disappointing him. Doors opened, a wary semicircle formed around him until the police came. Out came the heads too along Hudson Street, offering opinion. Drunk, crazy, a wild kid from the suburbs.
Yeah, yeah, these out-of-towners. Yeah.
And they're like, then there's another punchline in footnote, which is that on Hudson Street, we think the suburbs must be a tough place to raise children, which is obviously a kind of inversion of the normal story that's told about them.
And this whole thing is like both the strength and weakness of this, which is that she's correct. This is a not totally implausible model of the urban good life that does sort of exist. But the other side is it is an evidence base, which is through, I don't want to say exaggerated, but certainly very cherry-picked and optimized story of urban bliss. And that is the evidence base. That is how she justifies things.
Yeah. Hudson Street will be this kind of ideal for how the city should run, is the kind
but,
of...
And it feels to me, it may be that it was exactly like that, but it feels to me like a fable of what we're trying to go towards.
Yeah, it's a rather lovely fable.
But all the components of it are not things that we're unfamiliar with, right? I mean, it just seems like a little bit of a kind of overdone story in a way. If we're not judging this as a polemic, which is exactly what it is, and that's the job of a polemic.
And then there's another chapter, which again is about sidewalks and security, but where she's really interested in the problem of how it is that people trust each other, even though actually the nice thing about the city is that we don't really know each other. She's, I think, interested and really enjoys a particular kind of familiarity in the city where you sort of see someone, you recognize them, you might like kind of nod your head, you don't know their name, neither of you want to know each other's name, and this kind of and you're very comfortable with that kind of relationship, which I think she finds very precious. There's something about to a degree where she kind of pathologizes housing projects on the basis that they don't allow people to have that kind of relationship to each other in a way where I don't really understand
which
the
is
point
strange
that she's trying
on a
to
number
make.
Of levels, because it's not true.
It's obviously not true.
Like, that's exactly the relationship you have with people when you're in an ex-council block. The nodding and smiling relationship with your neighbours is exactly what you have. I mean, you can, like, if you've been there for a while, you can kind of know them a bit better, but, like, because people are moving in and out all the time, that tends to be how it goes. So what does she think about have we done what she thinks about good streets are in terms of the street design, or is that not in that bit yet?
That is a little bit later, but she has a stress on almost the first urban design actual proposal in the book is about the width of sidewalks, that they're good if they are about 30 feet 10 meters.
She's extremely wide,
but I think that could work.
It does. I mean, no, absolutely, like in bits of Paris you've got things like that,
yeah,
where it's really wide on the wide roads.
And then also it's nice if they do have trees now and then, which you can have if they're that wide.
It kind of implies a rather wide road. Like, the whole thing has to be wide, because, I mean, if our pavements were 10 metres wide, they would meet in the middle.
Yeah, I guess that's really the new paradigm in kind of street design, is wide pavements and narrow roads. What it takes to make a sidewalk successful is a particular conjunction of different things, isn't it? The width is important because it allows them to be used for all kinds of things, particularly it allows them to be used for children's play, that they can be where the kids go to play. And they play outside the house, or they play outside the shop or whatever. You need to have shops, because those obviously, and not just shops, but ideally bars. There's a day cycle dimension to this, which is very important for her, that you need to have a range of uses which ensure that there's always kind of different peaks of activity overlapping with one another and creating a kind of continuity of street life.
I've always felt that it's ideal to have pubs and primary schools next to each other. It really invigorates the street life.
I mean, that's one of the problems with the kind of neighbourhood dimension, like, dynamic, isn't it?
Yeah, like, strong resistance to the two things existing, yeah.
Strong resistance to the fun activities, actually.
Yeah.
If pubs were not so deeply embedded in London.
Oh, they would have got rid of them all. People are always trying to. I was only being semi-facetious, actually, about pubs, primary schools next to each other. I think it works really well. It's a sign of a good, sort of successful community when both those things exist together.
Yeah, absolutely. This is kind of looking ahead to sort of a later part of the book, but the idea of mixing up the uses, creating diversity, is an absolutely kind of axiomatic thing for her. One of her big terms of art is what she calls intricate mutual support, which, to kind of unpack, is lots of things, particularly small things of diverse kinds, which together create a particular sort of richness and harmonic kind of dynamic in the spaces between them. You know, the support, the thriving street with its sort of mutually assured security and all of these other benefits is created by all of the different types of shops with all of their different types of sort of diurnal cycles.
She's a great believer in the sturdy, upstanding shopkeeper. The barman is really like the core of society. He will gently nudge together lovelorn, broken-hearted people. He will gently arrange for unemployed into usher them into new employment productively.
Yeah, there's a lot of matchmaking is one of the... Also, the shopkeeper knowing what people are into and trying to...
Yes, trying to gently, like, coax the, like, two stamp collectors into a familiarity with each other.
Gradually increasing the sum total of human happiness.
To what extent is this completely fictional?
It's not your experience.
It's certainly not my experience, though. It's not my experience anywhere, anything like that. I mean, it's something that, like, could have happened. That's the sort of thing that you can imagine happening once. Yeah. Like, being a story. But it's definitely not like, it's definitely not part of how pubs and shops work, is it?
So this other part of the sidewalks, she's interested in, yeah, this kind of problem of trust that we live among strangers in the city. And yet we have a kind of settled expectation that they're not going to outrage us.
And if you go to different cities, you'll find different cities have very differing levels of trust.
The thing is, they can be eroded by all sorts of things. All sorts of events.
And also, it's not just a trust, it's a set of expectations about what the other person's behaviour is going to be.
This is one of the true things about Japan, isn't it? That you can, in many places, just sort of leave your possessions lying around for a number of hours and no one will take them.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. I don't know if it's still true, but people in Denmark used to just... It would be perfectly normal to, like, go to a cafe, leave your baby in the pram outside on the street... have coffee with your friend, and then come and pick the baby up half an hour later.
Or, yes, or in the kind of inverse. I remember someone telling me about their friend who'd recently moved to London and saying to him very clearly, if you leave your bike on that little lock, the, like, wheel lock thing, someone will steal it. And he didn't believe them and left it for 5 minutes and someone stole it.
Yeah, the spirit of entrepreneurialism is not completely dead in the city.
I feel like we should talk about parks because they're the kind of inverse to this. So streets, yes, parks, no.
Yeah, and there are certain things. Like the streets also have to be not too long or not too long in an uninterrupted way and they have to...
That all kind of comes in a bit later. There's a more detailed set of principles.
I think, yeah, well, sure. Well, again, some of them are actually introduced in the street bit. They're kind of doubled up, but we'll talk about them later. Yep.
Broadly, she's a park skeptic.
Well, she has a nuanced view of parks. Most people in cities think that parks are a good thing.
A kind of unalloyed good.
An unalloyed good. And she thinks that parks can be a bad thing. Often they are. And sometimes they can be a good thing as well. She also has the idea that you have big parks and small parks, which makes sense. She's generally for the small parks. Small neighbourhood parks, which she regards as sort of being good if, you know, reasonably well done. But big parks, she's often a bit sceptical of, yeah.
And she's sceptical about them precisely because they don't have this quality of being sufficiently sort of surveilled all the time, that they're frequently empty, that they frequently also sort of cut areas off for each other. Also, she's just sort of observes that, in her experience, people don't use them nearly as much as you might expect. This is the kind of anecdote, but she sort of says, you know, I was there on this beautiful sunny day. There was no one there. Everyone was on the streets instead. She does give some kind of anecdote that actually parents think that it's generally safer to have the kids playing on the street nearby than it is to have them go to the park. Various lurid things can happen to them there. They can be, like this poor 9-year-old boy, pushed down a sewer by an unidentified assailant. I don't know if I haven't written down. There are various outrages that are detailed throughout the book. Some of them picturesque, some of them are rather not.
And she has ideas about what makes a good and bad park of this description. The good, and it's rather like streets. Yeah. And also the sort of externalities that they have. So a good park obviously shouldn't be like have all the sun blocked out of it, but it also should be somewhere which can reasonably have a reasonable expectation of being inhabited through the day, as in being kind of embedded in a community. A bit like the one she described in the street, where people are working, there are children, there are people at leisure, there are teenagers. Everyone can kind of be there all at the same time. And bad parks get overrun by kind of monocultures. She's got a kind of notion, I think, that if you don't have a continuous positive force of upstanding citizens going to and fro in a place, it will get colonized. The three examples she gives are homeless people, perverts, and criminals. Will colonize in various different ways the park.
She's quite open-minded about homeless people.
She thinks that some homeless parks can be a jolly good thing.
And that she has like a sort of rather nice description of how they inhabit it during the day. And
the only good thing I think she had to say about Los Angeles was that one of the homeless parks wasn't terrible.
Well, yeah, that people kind of have all sorts of activities for themselves. She says that they...
She describes them sort of engaging in philosophical discussion.
Yeah, and also that they have certain benches, which they make signs reserving certain benches for ladies. Pervert's more equivocal on, although she thinks it's perfectly reasonable that they should take over, for example, this park in Philadelphia, which is deserted outside of office hours because it's in a kind of office monoculture area.
Yeah, well, they're perfectly unsurprising that they would do that. But she says that they have been, but it is possible to reclaim, and they have been successfully driven out of Washington Square by an increasing community being there. Yeah. And then there's also a category of criminal parks, which I think is one where you've got a sort of background of kind of like muggers standing around like anglerfish, hoping that one person's going to go by.
So, yeah, parks are more likely to succeed if they are surrounded by the life of the city as she conceives it. So, like the street, lots of different activities happening at different times and kind of drawing people continuously through and around. She also has some ideas about what makes parks successful in terms of the actual design of the park itself. The sort of two main points. It's kind of neither too much of one thing nor of too much of the other. On the one hand, you shouldn't just be able to see all of it in one go. There should be a little bit of mystery, but there should also be a proper middle. Those are her two kind of principles. I mean, that might be what's wrong with the park. Your closest park here is a bit rubbish.
What, the little tiny one immediately behind, or Vicky Park? She also has some interesting ideas about what parks do. Most people would not think of them as having many negative externalities, but she regards them as something which can potentially kind of kill off an area by just being a void, by being a block, by being something that like damages businesses around the edge of it.
In her idea of urbanism, like the urban vitality is this sort of movement of people which is kind of generated by the intensity of uses going on in different places, and that if you're in a sort of cul-de-sac, a park is a vacuum a lot of the time, and in that sense it won't really pull people through the areas which are adjacent to it and create that sort of intensity.
It's interesting, isn't it? And I think about it, it's like the sort of urban life that she's aspiring to, at least an idealized version of, is exactly that one which is in long-term decline, which is this super dense but quite low-rise, densely populated but quite low-rise city of the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, before people had cars, when there were just huge numbers of people engaging. They haven't got much indoor space, loads of stuff goes on in the street. Lots of stuff is all being sold and trained. People are moving around. There's hustle and bustle and density, you know, like late Victorian London or late Victorian New York. And that sort of urban condition exists and can exist later on, but it isn't the condition of cities. Like, cities develop lots of other conditions. Whereas that was the kind of mainstream of what an urban centre was like originally. Whereas now we kind of have different activities and different expectations, and the necessities of that is like having this very, very high population density. And lots of people don't want to live there anymore. It's like that's the model.
Yes, or rather it's a model of that when it has hollowed out a little bit and there's a little bit more space.
Yeah, it's become gentrified. Lots of people knock through their flats, but it hasn't become too much.
Yeah, but there's still the old kind of patterns are still sort of bedded in. Yeah, there's lots of great... I went back when we did Kafka and America. I went through lots and lots of pictures of New York from around the turn of the century. And the wonderful pictures of like the banana docks or the kind of warehouse streets and things.
If you look at pictures of London at the time, there's just so... If you get a time when actually taking a picture of normal street life, so many people everywhere. Like, streets actually full of people. It's so dense. There's so many tiny little shops, tiny, tiny, like kiosk level, and all the kind of work also is going on. Everything has to go on in the same place. All the industry and docks and everything is kind of all urban. Whereas now people are kind of linked with transport, and that's kind of, which is exactly what she wants. She wants, she said it right from the beginning of the streets. She wants people to work and kind of be in this, like people can move around in the city, but they're all very close, and all sorts of activities and industries and things are all there. Should we do, are we going to do districts, or are we just going to finish parks?
We should just talk about, yeah, because the last part of this, of part one, is about neighbourhoods or districts, or I understood as a kind of problem about identification, like how you, what is a something where you do have a meaningful identification with an, with a collective.
Yeah, and when you say identification, he means like identifying with as well as identifying it.
It has to be meaningful to kind of you in your life, but it also has to interface in this difficult way with the city, which she conceives significantly as kind of an adversary that's going to come and try and do horrible things, and which you need to try and stop, or you need to kind of get things off of.
Yeah, an adversary, but also not, she doesn't talk about city governments as a bad thing. I think she thinks they're a good thing, but they need to be kind of controlled. So she's got the idea of a street being a neighborhood, this kind of busy street life, and then the kind of what makes a kind of neighborhood level, which you think should be a certain size. She's talking about kind of like a borough, but like not like a borough like New York, though, like a borough like London, something much smaller, or perhaps even like the old boroughs before they all got joined together, like a sort of districts of some small number of tens of thousands of people, which is consisted of a number of these like street neighborhoods, but which has a kind of real identity as a place as well. I think it has to be that, and what makes a place identified. And then there is the properties of the street, the properties of that neighborhood, and the properties of the city. And in the city, she really talks about the governance of a city, and that it should exist, but it should be responsive. And there are some things that can only be done at the level of the city. And I think she's pro-city against... She believes that cities should have more rights against the countries and states they're in. Mm-hmm. And that it's important for a city to look after its cityness. She's very, very pro-urban. Like, there are kind of expanding circles of her, like, how she regards things. And really, what the best way of living that she can imagine, and really it's all about going towards this sort of way of living, is that urban, super dense urban, but kind of slightly old-fashioned way of having an urban district. The things that protect and nurture that are what is important. And it is nurtured at the street level. It is nurtured at the level of a district neighbourhood, a distinct kind of area which should have a character of its own, and where the different parts of that neighbourhood will support each other because they have a collective identity, and of a city which should be able to get the resources it needs for its neighbourhoods from, and not be sort of prey to the greater national government.
Good. Well, I think we might leave it there because we've talked a bit too long. So this is going to be a two-parter.
Yes.
And in the second part, we'll talk about the rest of the book.
Yeah, yeah. This has never happened before. I don't know. Gee, this is strange.
Sorry about that. So, we've kind of done the introduction and we've done the most famous part of the book. And then we'll get into the rest of it, which has got an awful lot of interesting stuff in it. And also some more questionable, but also kind of provocative principles of urban design.
Yeah, I mean, so far, most of what we've said is kind of stuff that's become increasingly received wisdom.
And like, very, very understandably so, yeah.
Some of the stuff about, like, parks kind of degrading the areas around them is a bit curious, but she does at least have a sort of vision for it, and it may have been true in the very specific circumstance. Later on, some of the stuff is a bit strange, some of it is very sensible, and most of it is kind of interesting to think about.
Good. All right. Well, remember that you're the bonus for this show, which will be...
We're going to do two bonuses. We're going to do two shows.
So we're going to do one about more of the kind of urban renewal context of Robert Moses. And also we'll talk about the Lomax scheme and Paul Rudolph's sort of visionary science fictional proposals for it.
I should think it'll be a not super like balanced. It'll be a bit of a romp through that because that's a big couple of topics.
And then we'll also do a bonus about
everything else she did. in her long career.
Yes, yes, her very long and storied career. Both her and Robert Moses lived into their 90s. And
she became a kind of public figure, although she didn't really... She was always interested in her particular campaigns, but didn't really sort of want to take on the role, I think, as a super public figure, even though she kind of was, managed to hold that line. And existed kind of into the internet age. So she's kind of... There's, you know, she was on podcasts.
Good. Well, thanks for joining us. Remember, we're at @about_buildings on all sorts of social media, and you can get bonus content by signing up to the Patreon at patreon.com/about_buildings. There's a link in the show notes. We're edited by Matthew Lloyd Roberts. Thanks, Matt.
Thank you very much.
And yeah, we'll be with you again soon. Got no deeds to do, no promises to keep. I'm dappled and drowsy and ready to sleep. Let the morning time drop all its petals on me. Life, I love you, all is groovy.